So whenever I discuss or give a talk on this topic, I'm asked, what can we do as people? What can we do? How do we contribute? It's not necessary for you to always think big. There are certain things that most people can do within their own circumstances, which is completely within their control. So I'm giving you three options. If you're running an institution or you're an entrepreneur, is it not possible for you to ensure that people who work for you are taken care of and they participate in your festivals and they're made to feel part of this system and this ecosystem and the Hindu fold? I'm talking of your Hindu employees at the very least. You don't need to impose your faith on anybody else. Is it not possible for you to ensure that when they're struggling for money, they don't go to some institution that says that I'm willing to offer you money provided you change your faith? Is that not within your control? Indic Renaissance, in its most lucid terms, in perhaps the most simplest of terms possible, is an urge, a plea to each of you members to take an active interest in the affairs of your community, to take an active interest in your own traditions, and to make sure that you pass on the traditions that you have got, which is perhaps a fraction of what your parents had. At least that fraction must go to your children, at the very least. Don't blame the schools for their education, because then you're effectively saying that schools are responsible for upbringing, we're only responsible for conception and delivery. You have had the child, so the children are yours. They are not the wards of the state. So as far as teaching is concerned, don't limit it or exclusively to the schools. Take an active interest in what is it that your child is learning. If textbooks are teaching nonsense and parents don't take an interest, they will assume that parents also endorse that nonsense. And if that brainwashing starts at this age, he will have absolutely no problems with anybody interfering with the Hindu institution. So there is only a point to which you can constantly blame others for your own mistakes, your own weakness, and your own inability to stand up for your traditions. But you can't stand up for your own traditions because you don't know your own traditions. Do not treat any of these talks as pastimes. I'm asking you to take ownership of at least one initiative, something that you believe in, and throw your weight behind it. If you're interested in reviving a certain art form, please see how is it that you can contribute to it. At the very least, take an interest in the temple which is in your locality and ask yourself who is running it. What is the level of state interference in it? Where does the money in the hundi go? Ask these questions. These are basic questions. This is doable. Not one suggestion that I've given is unreasonable. It doesn't require a stretch of your resources or imagination. It only requires you to put your money where your mouth is. So the next time you choose to whine about dharma, or you choose to whine about your religion, or you choose to whine about how the Indian state is hypocritical or is discriminatory towards Hindus, just ask yourself, have you taken at least one step? Have you contributed at least one brick to changing the status quo? If you have done nothing, I must say this bluntly, you do not have the right to whine. Under Article 19 or Article 14 or Article 21 or any of the free speech rights, while you have the freedom to speak and the freedom to express, we have unfortunately translated it to freedom to whine endlessly. This has become the nature of our society. So at the very least, anyone who seems to be a person of resources rushes to an ashram for salvation, God knows for what reason. I have to put this point. I have to say this. I'm sorry if I'm offending a lot of people. I'm simply paraphrasing what Vivekananda has said. You do not have a right to seek individual salvation when the rest of your society is struggling. You have not arrived at a phase where each of you can start going towards salvation. Go to any number of ashrams, patronize any number of babas, no problem, but come back to the temple. Because no matter which baba comes and which baba goes, the temple has to remain, it shall remain. It is your responsibility to ensure that it remains for eternity. Put your faith in any number of people. I won't use this phrase called Godman because according to me that's wrong. No problem. But the source is the temple. The root is the temple. The Gangotri is the temple. All of them derive their knowledge only from the temple and from the knowledge that has come from the temple. So whether they attribute their knowledge and their success to the temple or not, at least you should know where they draw their knowledge from. So my request to you would be, perhaps one generation has to swallow this poison pill for the next generation to continue calling itself practitioners of the Sanatan Dharma. In a democracy, what happens is, it is meant to give you the freedom to pursue your own goals, your own, let's say, dreams. But it also unfortunately gives you the luxury of passing on your duty to the next generation. I can't do it, somebody else will do it. And as a consequence, what you have handed over as legacy to the next generation is a set of problems which only keeps growing by the day. A set of identity-related challenges which only keeps piling up by the day. So the hope is, at least in my generation, we'll reduce the burden for the next generation, if not eliminate it. Help us. Help us by helping yourself. Take an active interest in the people around you. I'm sure at the very least, you can influence 5 people in your circles. I'm not asking you to convert. I'm asking you to tell them what you stand for. If somebody spits against your faith or your community in front of you, the very least you can do is to speak up and stand up for your community, as opposed to keeping your mouth shut out of some misplaced sense of politeness. Politeness is not in keeping your mouth shut when somebody is spewing venom against your faith. It's as good or as bad as respecting a friendship where the friend is actually spitting at your parents and you don't want to hurt the friend's sentiments. It's as stupid as that. Are you going to choose your parents over your friends? That is the question that you have to ask yourself. This is the simplest example that I can at least offer. Go back to the basics. Read Aurobindo. Read Swami Vivekananda. Read Madan Mohan Malviya. Read K.M. Munshi. Read Ambedkar. Do read him. I haven't found one intellectual in the last 60 years who comes anywhere close to his clarity of thought. He's one of the sterling individuals that we have produced. Whatever his angst may have been against certain scriptures, that was a product of the circumstances he was brought up in and the product of the circumstances he lived in. But remember, he never chose to convert outside the dharmic fold. He never chose to convert to any other faith despite all the incentives that were offered to him. He tried his best to ensure that caste discrimination and untouchability were reduced. And when he realized that he couldn't succeed, he went to the closest option available that allows him to remain within the fold, which is Buddhism. He did not convert to any other faith. So anybody who uses Ambedkar to divide this community is a motivated, useful idiot in the hands of those who have an agenda. He's useful for them and he's an idiot for me. So therefore, he's a useful idiot. So my request to you would be, as opposed to offering sweets to each other on festive occasions, distribute books. Make sure that people are aware of their roots. Community participation or community celebration of festivals is important. The very least that you must develop over a point of time is the power of argumentation. But you need information before you argue. So try and equip yourself with as much information as possible. When your child asks you the reason for a certain practice, at least admit that you don't know and try to answer the question the next time he asks you the question, as opposed to saying this is some superstition. Merely because you know nothing, it can't be superstition. That is not the definition of superstition as far as I know it. So my request to you would be, if you can't think of the society, let's be Indians and be selfish. Think of yourself, think of your family, think of your children, and for their own sake, take an active interest in protecting your traditions.